The next item of business is a statement by Marie Goujon on the independent review of Grouse Moor management. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, so there should be no interventions or interruptions, and I call on Marie Goujon for up to 10 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In 2017, the Cabinet Secretary for Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform commissioned an independent group to look at the environmental impact of Grouse Moor management. The group had a clear remit to examine the environmental impact of Grouse Moor management practices such as muir burn, the use of medicated grit in mountain hare culls, and advise on the option of licensing grouse shooting businesses. This group was part of a package of measures aimed at tackling the ongoing and abhorrent issue of wildlife crime, and in particular, raptor persecution. The Cabinet Secretary's decision to form the review group was prompted by the report from Nature Scot in May 2017, which found that around a third of satellite-tagged golden eagles in Scotland disappeared in suspicious circumstances on or around grouse moors. This government has stated repeatedly that we intend to bring an end to the illegal killing of raptors and to bring in whatever measures are necessary to achieve this. Addressing wildlife crime remains a key priority both for this government and for me personally. The independent Grouse Moor Management Report, also known as the Werity Report, was published in December last year. And first of all, I would like to put on record my thanks to Professor Werity, the members of the review group and their advisers for undertaking this work, as well as the broad range of stakeholders who contributed their views and experience. Grouse Moor management is a complex and controversial issue. It attracts strong views and a great deal of public interest, and I don't for one minute underestimate the challenges faced by the review group. I hope that we can all agree that their report takes a comprehensive, evidence-led and balanced approach to the key issues surrounding the management of grouse moors in 21st century Scotland. I have given full consideration to the recommendations and findings of the Grouse Moor Management Group, alongside the evidence they gave to the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee earlier this year. I have reviewed the findings from the Phase 1 and Phase 2 Scottish Government commissioned research on the socio-economic and biodiversity impacts of grouse moor management. I have also taken into account the recommendations of the Independent Deer Working Group and the Climate Change Committee report, where they relate to relevant activities such as muir burn. I've considered all of the evidence and views put forward by stakeholders, including meetings with, for example, the British Association for Shooting and Conservation, the Revive Coalition, the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, and the Scottish Wildlife Trust. And I want to thank everyone who took their time to share their views with ministers and with officials. Presiding Officer, after taking into account all of this evidence, I've reached the conclusion that there is a need for greater oversight of the practices associated with grouse moor management, including muir burn and the culling of mountain hares. The key recommendation put forward in the Werity report is that a licensing scheme be introduced for the shooting of grouse. This is a recommendation that I accept. However, while I understand why the review group also recommended that such a scheme should be introduced if, after 5 years, there is no marked improvement in the ecological sustainability of grouse moor management, I believe that the government needs to act sooner than this and begin developing a licensing scheme now. As recently published in our Phase 2 research, we recognise the contribution that grouse shooting makes to the rural economy and that the majority of those tasked with managing land already follow best practice guidance and care deeply about the countryside and land that they manage. I cannot, though, ignore the fact that some of the practices associated with grouse moor management, such as muir burn and the use of medicated grit, have the potential to cause serious harm to the environment if the correct procedures are not followed. Neither can I ignore the fact that despite our many attempts to address this issue, every year birds of prey continue to be killed or disappear in suspicious circumstances on or around grouse moors. Since 2007, the Scottish Government has undertaken a range of measures to tackle wildlife crime, including the introduction of vicarious liability, a poisons disposal scheme, and restrictions on licences for those operating on land where it is suspected that wildlife crime has taken place. The fact that raptor persecution continues in spite of all these measures suggests that while regulation from within the grouse shooting industry can be an important factor in driving behavioural change, self-regulation alone will not be enough to end the illegal killing of raptors, and further intervention is now required. Now, there are many forms that a licensing scheme could take. I don't propose to go through them all here. We will consult on the detail of the scheme in due course. The basic proposition, however, is that a licence will be required to operate a driven Grouse Moor business, and that if there is strong evidence of unlawful activity or serious breaches of codes of practice by that business, then their licence could be withdrawn. I recognise this is a serious sanction, and we would therefore take steps to ensure that no credence is given to any vexatious or malicious claims of malpractice. In introducing licensing arrangements in this way, we're bringing our system closer into line with those that apply in other comparable countries, where greater regulation of shooting and hunting is the norm, in order to protect animal welfare and avoid damage to the environment and biodiversity. When developing the licensing scheme, we will work closely with the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, Scottish Land and Estates, the British Association for Shooting and Conservation, and others representing those involved in managing and taking part in grouse shooting. I would now like to turn to some of the other recommendations in the report. Muirburn is a complex issue, and the research to date suggests that it can have both beneficial and adverse effects. If it is undertaken without due consideration of all the possible consequences, it has the potential to have a serious negative impact on wildlife and the wider environment. However, it can also bring positive benefits in some cases, for example, by helping to reduce fuel loads and thereby reduce the risk of wildfire. Therefore, while I do not believe that a full ban on Muirburn, as some have called for, is either necessary or warranted, I am clear that further regulation, particularly when it comes to Muirburn on peatland, is required. Presiding Officer, in future, Muirburn will only be permitted under licence from Nature Scot, regardless of the time of year it is undertaken. And there will be a statutory ban on burning on peatland, except under licence for strictly limited purposes, such as habitat restoration. And reflecting that Muirburn is undertaken throughout Scotland for a variety of purposes, these measures will apply to all Muirburn, not just when it is undertaken in relation to Grouse Moor management. We will also revisit the current definition of peatland and take expert advice on whether it should be revised and a stricter definition imposed. While some of these measures go further than the recommendations made by the review group, I believe they are necessary to protect our environment and in particular our peatlands, which, as I know everyone here understands, play a crucial role in our carbon storage and climate change mitigation strategies. Lastly, I wish to today address some of the recommendations on medicated grit and mountain hares. On medicated grit, which is a veterinary preparation used to suppress parasite worms and grouse, the Werity Review recommended that SEPA should initiate a desk-based study to ascertain whether residues of the active chemical flubendazole are present in water bodies. The report also recommended that Nature Scot should publish a code of practice on the use of medicated grit and that all land managers should adhere to the code to prevent any risk of contamination or of the substance reaching the human food chain. I can confirm today that the SEPA study has been concluded and the Scottish Government will now work with stakeholders to produce guidance on best management practices for the use of medicated grit. We will also convene an expert group to study how best to monitor compliance with the code of practice going forward. As everyone in this chamber will be aware, earlier this year the Scottish Parliament voted to support a Stage 3 amendment of the Animal and Wildlife Penalties, Protections and Powers Scotland 2020 Act. This amendment, which granted full protected species status to mountain hares, meets and in some respects goes further than the recommendations made by the Werity Review. The arrangements for licensing of mountain hare control, where this is necessary, are now being taken forward as part of the implementation work for the 2020 Act. Turning to what happens next, the Scottish Government will shortly bring forward an SSI to enact the provisions in the Animal and Wildlife Penalties, Protections and Powers Scotland Act 2020, which give greater protection to mountain hares. We intend that the new arrangements will come into effect at the end of February 2021, and so the open season for killing mountain hares, which finishes on that date, will be the last such season. If re-elected, this government will bring forward the necessary legislation in the next parliament to license Grouse Moor management and to strengthen the existing legislation on Muirburn, including a range of appropriate penalties that could be applied in cases of non-compliance. Any new legislation will of course be preceded by full consultation in the normal way. The Werity Review made over 40 recommendations and I'm conscious that I haven't been able to cover them all today. We will publish a full response to all the recommendations in the report later today, alongside SEPA's desk-based study. Presiding Officer, I know that the measures I've announced today will not be welcomed by everyone. Some will be concerned at what they perceive to be interference in legitimate land management strategies and activities, and there will no doubt be others who feel that the Scottish Government has not gone far enough. But it's clear to me we could not continue with the status quo. We all benefit from our natural environment, and we all have a responsibility to ensure that it is not only protected, but enriched. The changes that I've announced today strike what I believe to be the right balance. They are not designed to bring an end to grouse shooting. Indeed, those businesses which comply with the law should have no problems at all with licensing. But crucially, where there is clear evidence that this is not happening, where agreed standards are not being adhered to, or there is evidence of illegal raptor persecution, there will be a range of effective and transparent mechanisms in place to allow us to address that behaviour. I look forward to discussing these measures with members of this Parliament and key stakeholders over the coming months. Thank you.
The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statements. I can allow about 20 minutes for that, and we do have a lot of questions, so I would appreciate members being succinct. And I first of all go to Liz Smith.
Hey, Presiding Officer, can I thank the Minister for prior sight of her statement and welcome the fact that after a very lengthy and costly delay, the Scottish Government has finally responded to this very important review, because there can be absolutely no doubt that this response matters hugely to the future of our rural communities, many of which have been suffering significant fragility in recent years in the pandemic. And the Scottish Government knows too that these communities are essential to Scotland's green recovery and economic regeneration, and in tackling the deplorable activity of raptor crime. But I think that many of these communities will be deeply disturbed by some of the key aspects in the Scottish Government's response. So can I ask the Minister some important questions? Firstly, given that the Scottish Government has committed to base policy on clear evidence, why has it chosen to move against the very clear Werity recommendation that there should be a period of 5 years in which to collect the necessary evidence from ecological studies before any decision is made about licensing, because that's surely contrary to the stated aims of the Scottish Government? Secondly, the Minister has said that she hasn't yet decided on what type of licensing scheme will be implemented. But could you give us some idea of the intention as to who would be the licence? Would that be the landowner, the land occupier, or the shooting tenant? Because that's not clear from the Minister's statement. It simply refers to shooting business, and I think that definition would have to be tightened up. And lastly, can I ask what burden of proof would be used to revoke any licence?
Marie Goujon.
I thank Liz Smith for those very important questions, and I'll try to respond to them all. In relation to Liz Smith's first point about the Werity Group's recommendation about waiting 5 years for licensing, now, I think we have to look at exactly what that would have entailed. This has, as the member will be aware, and members right across this chamber will be aware, there have been a lot of ongoing issues here that we've been attempting to deal with for, I mean, I talked about some of the measures we've introduced since 2007, and still these problems have persisted. Now, if we were to wait 5 years for that, that doesn't take into account that after that five-year period, we then have to potentially look at all the different issues we're considering now in terms of licensing. And we have to also take recognizance of the fact that that would involve making changes to primary legislation. That, of course, takes more time. So what we could essentially be looking at before to be able to enact all of those changes could potentially be another 8 years away. That's just too far. We've had these problems for a number of years. We need to do what we can to deal with them now. And as members will also be aware, and the Environment Committee took evidence on this when Professor Werity and some of the other members of the Werity Group and the Grouse Moor Management Group attended the committee meeting, that wasn't exactly a unanimous decision. There were very particular reasons why a five-year time limit was settled on. Now, I understand that this can be concerning and will be very concerning for those who work, who manage our land and who work in the grouse shooting industry. But again, one point that I would reiterate is the fact that exactly as I've said in my statement, those who are already managing the land as best they can, those who are already abiding by the law, which is the majority of people, have nothing to fear from a licensing system. This is not a system that is designed to catch them out. It's a way of trying to really tackle these persistent issues that have still remained despite all the other measures that we've put in place. And just to give an idea, from some of the evidence that the Environment Committee took from Professor Hester, if a land manager is currently managing their land according to the best available knowledge, which may be drawn from codes of practice, a licensing scheme should make no change, plus or minus, because the land is already being managed as well as it can be. A change should only occur if the land is not currently being managed in the best possible way. Anyone who is managing their land well should not see any change if the licensing scheme is introduced. In relation to Liz Smith's other questions about the type of scheme, again, and who the licence would be for or apply to, these will all form part of our considerations as we take these proposals forward.
Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Minister for the prior sight of her statement. Scottish Labour have long called for a licensing system, and the Minister's statement today is very welcome for the sake of the nature and climate emergencies and the sustainable future of rural economies. In view of the gravity of the situation, will the Minister reconsider and commit today or in the near future to bringing forward a consultation and licensing in this Parliament in spite of the many other challenges? And does the Minister agree that the estimated 1 million hectares of Scotland used as driven grouse moors is an example of the injustice inherent in Scotland's land ownership patterns and land use patterns? It is disappointing that the Scottish Government's response to the League Against Cruel Sports report that found that nearly half of the animals killed in killing devices in Scotland are not target animals, such as hedgehogs and dippers. And will the Cabinet Secretary agree today to look at this part of the possibilities of licensing as we go forward? Thank you.
Marie Goujon.
I just want to assure Claudia Beamish, as I would want to assure everyone across this chamber today, that because of the changes that we need to introduce and the fact that if we are introducing licensing, that would require changes to primary legislation, as I know that all members will be aware, we simply do not have the time within the remaining time that we have left of this Parliament to be able to do all the work that we need to do to bring forward that legislation. But I want to assure her and assure all members that that doesn't mean the work doesn't start now. It will be starting now to lay the way and prepare all the groundwork for all the work that will then be needed, that we will then need to do as part of the next Parliament. So I really just want to give her an assurance on that.
Now, the opening questions have taken too much time. We move to the open questions. Could I ask everyone to bear brevity in mind? Gillian Martin, followed by Jamie Halcrow-Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to thank the Minister for working with the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee on this issue and for the very welcome measures and the swift application of them that she's announced today. People throughout Scotland have raised concerns for decades that driven grouse moors have a destructive effect on Scotland's biodiversity. With the measures outlined in today's statement, how will these concerns be addressed?
Marie Goujon.
I thank Gillian Martin for that question because I believe the majority, well, in fact, I hope all the recommendations that we've announced in response to the Wereksey report today will have a very significant effect in supporting biodiversity. Because the primary objective of the Wereksey report was to address the illegal killing of raptors. And I think if we can reduce that crime and that absolutely abhorrent crime, we can help protect the populations of some of our rarest and some of the most iconic species that we have in Scotland, such as the golden eagle and the hen harrier. And I think that I don't need to tell Gillian Martin this as convener of that committee, but I know that Professor Werity had said in his evidence to the committee as well that if grouse shooting were to be licensed and that was to be successful, the conservation of hen harriers would be considerably enhanced. We also believe that the tighter regulation of Muirburn will also protect the habitat of species such as ground nesting birds, and tighter regulation of trapping will reduce the risk of non-target species such as dippers and red squirrels being caught. So in all these ways and more, these changes will protect and nurture our precious biodiversity, and I know that's something that people right across Scotland would want.
Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, followed by Angus MacDonald.
Thank you. The independent review pointed to the lack of an agreed definition of grouse shooting business as a key barrier to proposals around licensing. And while I appreciate what she said about the Minister said about moving towards a consultation on the details of the scheme, businesses have already expressed considerable concerns about these proposals and will want to know as soon as possible how they will be impacted. So could the Minister indicate, at least for now, what work has been done in terms of identifying which businesses will be affected, and further what discussions she will have with these businesses directly ahead of any formal consultation?
Marie Goujon.
Thank you. I would say that what we're proposing in terms of licensing right now would apply to driven grouse shooting. That's where we see it applying to. But again, a lot of these issues we need to tease out and we need to look at in more detail. And I really would want to assure the member, and again, everyone across this chamber too, that in formulating our response to the Werity report, we undertook engagement with all interested parties to that. And that will be absolutely vital to the work that we do going forward. So I fully intend to engage. My officials will engage with that, because I think when we're making these changes, of course, we have to include and hear from the people that they are going to affect. So I really just want to give him that assurance, give other members assurance that we will be undertaking that engagement and making sure that we have, and of course, we will have a full consultation as part of that too. So we will be taking all these views on board.
Angus MacDonald, followed by Alec Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome all of the actions detailed in the Minister's statement. However, by way of clarification, can the Minister outline who will oversee the licensing regime and how this will interact with criminal investigations, which are the responsibility of the police?
Marie Goujon.
As I've responded to in previous answers to some questions from members, we will, of course, set out our proposals for a future licensing scheme in due course. However, I would say that it is likely that it would be Nature Scot who would be responsible for issuing licences and, of course, monitoring compliance with the licensing conditions too. And, of course, when it comes to criminal investigations or any suspicions of criminal activity, Police Scotland would continue to be responsible for investigating any of those allegations.
Alec Rowley, followed by Gail Ross.
I also welcome the Scottish Government's announcement today. I especially welcome the introduction of the licence scheme for grouse shooting, and this is a step in the right direction. However, when it comes to raptor persecution and illegal cullings, what action is the Scottish Government planning to take to ensure that those responsible are facing the penalties for their illegal actions? The killing of wild birds of prey is currently already illegal, and yet, despite widely publicised instances that taking place, there have been zero prosecutions in Scotland. What measures can the government take, on top of licensing grouse moors, to ensure the protection of our iconic wild birds of prey?
Marie Goujon.
I would say, in response to that question, I mean, that's why we've undertaken all the measures that we have so far. But I mean, by its very nature, where wildlife crime takes place, it's about the evidence gathering, and that can be a very difficult thing to do and to prove. But I mean, as part of that, we have provided extra resources to Police Scotland to enable them to have more resources to be able to better police wildlife crime as far as they can. The member will, of course, be aware of the Animals and Wildlife Act, which was passed by the Scottish Parliament earlier this year, where we increased the penalties quite significantly to recognise the seriousness of these crimes that take place. But alongside that as well, that also meant that we have more time to investigate some of these crimes, as well as the impact that can have on when and how surveillance can take place. So there are a lot of measures that have already been introduced, and I believe that by introducing licensing, that will help complete that package so that we really can end these abhorrent crimes once and for all.
Gail Ross, followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Professor Werity writes in his report that he didn't fully appreciate the complexity of the issues, the passion with which they are held, nor the length of time the review would require when he accepted the invitation to lead the review. My feeling is today that the Minister has achieved that very difficult balance between estates and gamekeepers and environmental NGOs. Can I thank her for that? But what can be done now to build trust and to get stakeholders together in a constructive and positive manner?
Marie Goujon.
I thank Gail Ross for that question because I think that she raises a very important point. And as she states, that was one thing that had been mentioned, I think, in the opening of the Werity report by Professor Werity, where he identifies the passion and the strength of feeling on both sides, and that was something that he hadn't fully appreciated. And I would also say that it's something that I'm acutely aware of in my role, where I often have to deal with some of these complex issues. And often, very often, they can, and all too often, they can be portrayed in a very black and white way, when in reality, it's never all that straightforward. I think there is a lack of trust on both sides, a lack of understanding, and that all feeds into and leads to that completely polarised opinion. So I genuinely hope that the measures that I've outlined today I hope that they will bring a greater transparency, which I hope in turn can help build some of that trust. But again, the member raises a vitally important point that I hope we can develop and build on.
Mark Ruskell, followed by Liam MacArthur.
The Greens welcome the proposals here on Muirburn, but licensing schemes are only as effective as the aims of those who design them. And it appears this licensing scheme could end up being designed by the usual suspects, who every week take to social media to deny that there is a wildlife problem on our state. That would be like putting arsonists in charge of a fire station. Will the minister put the interests of wildlife at the centre of the design of a licence by including RSPB, SWT, Raptor Study Groups and the SSPCA? Will she ensure any licensing scheme is linked to a statutory code of practice? And will she give clarity on the timescale for its introduction?
Mary Gujan.
Again, as I said in my previous response to Jamie Halcrow-Johnson, engaging with all parties, and there will be a consultation as part of this before any licensing scheme is introduced. It's within our best interest, and it's something we've sought to do throughout this whole process, is engage with all interested parties. And that would involve those who would have to apply for the licence, those who would be responsible for operating those licences as well. So we will, of course, take all of these views into consideration. The member has asked again about timescales. Again, this requires changes to primary legislation. It's not possible for us to introduce that within the time that we have left of this parliamentary session. But that is why the work will be starting now. So while we can't introduce those changes to primary legislation or bring those forward just yet, that doesn't mean no work will be taking place, and we'll be getting started on that immediately.
Liam MacArthur, followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Scottish Liberal Democrats have been calling for licensing of driven grouse moors, so I very much welcome the Minister's statement. There needs to be a better balance in the interests of animal welfare, the environment and biodiversity. And as the Minister says, this can protect responsible operators too. Subject to the election, the Government says it will legislate in the next Parliament, but will it consult on provisions in the remainder of this session? And will that consultation include a draft bill?
Mary Gujan.
That is something I'd be happy to keep the member updated on, and of course any other member across the chamber who wants to know that information. Of course, it's not possible for me to absolutely set out in stone today exactly when that consultation will take place, because obviously there is a lot of groundwork that must be done before we even reach that stage, and we need to shape what a scheme will look like. So I want to assure him that we will be progressing with this work as far as we possibly can within the remaining parliamentary time that we have, and I'd be more than happy to keep him updated on that as it progresses.
Finlay Carson, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
I start by repeating that the Scottish Conservatives absolutely condemn the abhorrent persecution of raptors in the strongest terms. The Minister states that while some of these measures go further than the recommendations made by the review group, and that she believes they are necessary to protect her environment, can the Minister direct members to her scientific evidence which suggests that the review group got it wrong? Perhaps some of the same evidence also led the Minister to imply she does not see the need for a complete ban on Muirburn or further restriction grouse moor management beyond the licensing scheme announced today. Will she now categorically rule out those actions in the future?
Mary Gujan.
I'm sorry, I have to disagree with the way that Finlay Carson has portrayed some of the work there, and I don't understand his point about the Werity group been getting it wrong or where that contradicts the evidence that we have. I'm sure he'll be aware of the phase one and phase two research that we had commissioned and which had published. I think what was good about the Werity group is the fact that it identified a lot of the gaps in the evidence that were there, some of which we have filled in that interim period. But that's where all these measures that we're introducing are absolutely vital. We talk about the introduction of codes of practice, the monitoring of that, because it's absolutely vital that we are able to update these and keep them as up to date as science develops. And when it comes to things such as Muirburn, for example, that's where our recommendations there, I think, are very important and follow the recommendations within the Werity review group. But of course, we are in some areas, we are going a bit further. We need to make sure that the definitions we have, such as the definition of peatland, which right now is defined as organic, has to have organic content of about 60% and be over 50 centimetres in depth. Is that still relevant? And these are the kind of things that we need to consider and ensure all that information is kept up to date. So I want to assure him again that we will be going through all these issues and details in detail as we bring forward a scheme. And I want to reiterate again that those who are already working to best practice and abiding by the law have nothing to fear from a licensing scheme. And if anything, what a licensing scheme will do is, one of the problems identified in the Werity review group and in other phases of research is the fact that we didn't know where all the grouse shooting businesses were. It helps us to have a better idea of where the businesses are, how they are operating, and really gives a more transparent picture of what's going on across Scotland.
If you could be very quick, please, Mr. Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Welcome to this long-awaited statement. The Minister will be aware of the killing and disappearance of birds of prey during the lockdown. Can she expand on how the measures announced today will deter further raptor persecution? Can she outline when all 40 recommendations will be fully implemented and the full consultation taken forward?
Marie Goujon.
Everyone across this chamber and right across Scotland has been completely angered, I would say, by the reports of killings and the disappearances of birds of prey that appear to have taken place during lockdown. And I know that we all agree that raptor persecution is completely unacceptable, but not only that, it's also illegal. Unfortunately, there will always be a minority of people who think that they're above the law and think that the rules don't apply to them. But that's again where I believe that the proposals we've outlined today will build on the other actions that we've taken as a government to try and address wildlife crime, as well as sending a clear message that this kind of criminal behaviour will have consequences. And a licensing regime will help to ensure that where there is clear evidence of illegal raptor persecution, we have the full range of effective and transparent mechanisms in place that really will allow us to address that behaviour.
I'm going to allow one last question from Alison Johnson.
Thank you. On average, 26,000 mountain hares are killed in Scotland annually in the mistaken belief that this boosts grouse numbers. And I'm concerned that by delaying bringing in this protection that Parliament voted for in June until next March, the Scottish Government has just given the green light for what could be the biggest mass killing of mountain hares ever seen. So can the Minister explain why she has given the shooting lobby this one last hurrah?
Marie Goujon.
I'm sorry, but I just have to completely disagree with what Alison Johnson has stated there. And it's not about giving shooting interests one last chance at this, because right now there's an open season, there is a closed season. And I would just reiterate what I said during the debate that we had last week about biodiversity, where this point was raised. Now, the amendment that was brought forward by Alison Johnson to the Animals and Wildlife Bill was lodged at the last minute. There was no previous discussion on it. It hadn't been raised before, and neither the government or Parliament had had the chance to scrutinise it. Now, the government and the Parliament agreed to that amendment, and rightly so. But we were left then with a lot of the groundwork to do after that bill was passed. Because again, we need to make sure there is a licensing scheme there that is fit for purpose and it does what we need it to do. So we therefore needed to take that time to undertake that work to ensure we have a licensing scheme that will work efficiently and effectively. And I'm sure that the member is aware of that and should be able to understand the reasons as to why that could not and could not possibly have been implemented immediately.
That concludes questions on the statement of the independent review of Grouse Moor management. Apologies to both Colin Smith and Richard Lyle for being unable to take their questions. And could I suggest to all members that perhaps they have a think about how long their questions take and how long the answers take if they want all colleagues to get a fair shout when we come to these statements. We'll move on to the next item of business. Please take care about social distancing and mask wearing when you're leaving the chamber.